stand. So what can I say? What can I do? But offer this heart, oh God, completely to you. So I'll walk upon salvation, your Spirit.
We just come to you this morning and we want to give you praise and thanks and bring you honor and glory to your name. Lord, I just pray that we just would worship you this morning with our whole hearts. And I thank you for all that you are, Lord, that you are with us every moment of every day. Lord, I thank you that we have the privilege to gather here and worship and bring honor to your name freely. Lord, I just ask you would open our hearts and minds this morning to hear from your word. And would you just bless Dan as he brings your word to us. In your name I pray. Amen.
live event. Probably noticed that our Wi-Fi has been out a couple of weeks. We're having problems with the Wi-Fi here. But you can still, if you have your phone, you can still access the notes through your cellular connection if you desire to. So we still have them on there. If you have not being able to get them, I've had a few people have complained to me about that. So we need to make sure we get our Wi-Fi up and running here again soon. This morning I was asleep in bed. It was 4:30 and 4:29 to be precise. And my phone, my text alert went off on my phone. And I don't have like a real loud alert, but whenever it goes off, I hear it. I heard it 4:29, and I'm thinking 4:30 in the morning. You know, somebody's texting this time. You know, maybe it's a prayer request. But normally, when I get a text early on Sunday morning, my mind immediately goes to Darren Gennady. And I don't get that many texts from him, maybe once every few months, but if I get one early on Sunday morning, it's often Darren Kennedy, but I'm like, 4:30? You know, it can't be. But anyway, I had to look, and I flipped over and looked at the phone, and I had a text from Darren. And Darren is a kid. For those of you who don't know him, I call him a kid, but he's actually closer to 30 than he is. We're 25 now, but Darren, anyway, was a part of our church here in the beginning, was a part of the worship team, and then was probably only here for a year, maybe 2 years at the most, before he went away to school, he went away to college. He went away to college, he got plugged into a church up in the Williamsport area, ended up getting a job there, and that's where he's at. He stayed there. Very connected with this church. Great kid. Love the guy. And so I get these really encouraging texts from Darren. And so at 4:29 this morning, I got this from Darren. It says, I was getting a little Devo in this morning. When he says that, he's talking about devotion time. I was getting a little Devo in this morning before I headed up to church today, and I read Colossians 1:28. Made me think of our church, Colossians 1:28, kind of the theme verse for our church here. He said he read that this morning, and he made us think of our church. Well, I just want to stop there, because when he said our church, I'm like, that is so stinking cool. Because Darren hasn't been here for 4 years, and yet he thinks of this as our church, because he was a part of this. He was sent from this church, in a sense. And so he goes on to say this. He says, proud of you, praying for you today, that you'd be filled with the knowledge of his will and all spiritual wisdom and understanding, so that you walk in a manner worthy of the Lord, to please him in all respects, which he is, because Christ is in you. You're his precious child, and bearing fruit in every good work and increasing your knowledge of God. Colossians 1:9-12. And then he says this. You are loved, appreciated, and qualified. It's Sunday, and the tomb is still empty. Time to party. Love you. And so I got that at 4:30 this morning, and I'm like, oh, just, you know, praise you, Jesus. I mean, I'm like, that is so stinking cool. And so I haven't been back to sleep. I laid there for 30 minutes, you know, just kind of thinking about that and reveling in that, then just the encouragement this morning. And so finally I got up and I just started kind of working on my sermon and just kind of sitting around, drinking some coffee, getting ready for the day. But when I read that and I get these things from Darren, I'm like, man, he gets it. He understands it. He left here, but he left here on a mission. He left here, and it wasn't just, I'm not in church anymore, I'm done. He went out of the door understanding that when he leaves here, he was on mission. And so that mission didn't end when he left here. In fact, when he refers to it, our church, he even sees, I think, his mission still is rooted in this church, this sending church, really. And so when I read that, and I see some of the things the other kids are doing in our church, Faith and Tyler and these kids that are just have left here but are just connected in churches and serving in different ways, I'm like, man, that is why we exist. That's what this is about. We said we're a missional church, and so everyone who's leaving here is on mission. And I recognize this. I see this, that some people really get that. Some people understand that, and they're living that to the fullest. And some of us, well, we struggle a little more with that. But when we go to where we're at here in Acts chapter 3, I want you to notice what happens in the book of Acts. Because last week, we looked at the fellowship of the church. We looked at what it looks like when the church is being the church. What church should look like when we're together. And we looked at that last week, and I want you to notice what happens immediately. The next day, or that day, I don't know, it doesn't give us days, but what immediately follows in the scriptures, they go out the door and they walk into the mission field. Now, I am relatively certain that they didn't plan for it. That this just happened to be on the way. This was what was in front of them as they left the church in whatever form that would have been in those days. But we have a hard time getting this. We have a hard time understanding this. That is what we're all called to be. And so when we came together, when we formed this church, and we said we're a missional church, I want you to get it, understand it, that means that every one of you are on mission. That we come here together on Sunday morning to be encouraged, to be fed, to be discipled, and then every one of us walk out the door into the mission field and begin serving in that mission field. Ed Stetzer is a person who's written books extensively in the whole missional thinking. And he says this, when Jesus said, as the Father has sent me, I also send you. The mandate was not for a select group of cross-cultural missionaries. It was a commission to you, to me, and to our churches. And so we look at the book of Acts, and Acts 1:8 says, you are going to be my witnesses. You guys will hear this so many times over the next year that you will hopefully all know it very well. You are going to be my witnesses in Jerusalem, in Judea, in Samaria, and to the ends of the earth. The rest of the book of Acts is that coming true. And so right here, they've just come out of church. They've just left Sunday morning worship, even though that would not be the case. But they've just left the church, and they're headed out. And I want you to notice, they are heading out to the mission field. They are stepping into Jerusalem. And that's where they're going to minister on that day. And that's going to, as we follow through the book of Acts, it goes Jerusalem, Judea, Samaria, the ends of the earth. It's fulfilled in the book of Acts. And so we see them here really beginning that mission on this particular day as Peter and John leave church and head to the temple for their prayer time. And so we're going to look at that today. We're going to consider that today is what does it look like? What does mission look like? What is needed to make sure that we are fulfilling the mission, that we are accomplishing the mission? And ultimately, how do we know? How do we know that the mission is actually accomplishing something? We're going to look at that also. So as we work through Acts chapter 3, we're going to look at the first 10 verses today. And we are going to consider, we are going to take a look and consider what it means to live as a missional fellowship. And before we look at God's word, though, let's pray together. Father, I thank you today for your word. I thank you for the just hope and the encouragement that's found in it. I pray, Lord, that we'll be equipped by it today. We will be changed by it today. God, I thank you for those people. God, I think they're there this morning. I thank you for him, Lord. I thank you for his encouragement, for his love. I thank you, Lord, that he looked at this verse 5 years ago, and he understood it. He knew what you were talking about, and he has pursued that with his life. Lord, I pray that for each of us. That God, we will understand this, and this will guide our steps and lead us to whatever mission field it is you're calling us today. Bless us as we look at your word. Change us. We thank you and pray these things all in Jesus' name. Amen. So in Acts chapter 3, first 10 verses, here's what it says. One day Peter and John were going up to the temple at the time of prayer at 3 in the afternoon. Now a man crippled from birth was being carried to the temple gate called Beautiful, where he was put every day to beg from those going to into the temple courts. When he saw Peter and John about to enter, he asked them for money. Peter looked straight at him, as did John. Then Peter said, "Look at us." So the man gave them his attention, expecting to get something from them. Then Peter said, "Silver or gold I do not have, but what I have I give you. In the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, walk." Taking him by the right hand, he helped him up, and instantly the man's feet and ankles became strong. He jumped to his feet and jumping and praising God. When all the people saw him walking and praising God, they recognized him as the same man who used to sit begging at the temple gate called Beautiful. and they were filled with wonder and amazement at what had happened to them. It says, one day, when they were going to the temple for, in quotes here, the time of prayer. Now, I think that is really, really important. In fact, when we look at the book of Acts, you get the idea pretty quickly that prayer was pretty important to those early disciples. In fact, I just want to, we've gone through, in the first two chapters and one verse, we have learned this. Chapter 1, verse 14, they all joined together constantly in prayer. Acts chapter 1, verse 24, then they prayed. Acts 2, 42, they devoted themselves to the apostles' teaching and the fellowship, to the breaking of bread, and to prayer. And now, Acts chapter 3, they are headed to the temple for the time of prayer. In fact, we even know what time it was. It says it was 3 o'clock. Now, I think this is significant. Because I look at the church today, I look at myself today, and I think about prayer and how we operate, how we function in prayer. I think this is what we're really good at when it comes to prayer today. I'm in a crisis. Things are tough. Life is painful. I can pray for that, right? If right now the world's crushing me, I can pray. I'll pray for that. We understand, that's a good thing. Or this, I get a text on my phone. Somebody is going to surgery. They need prayer. I can do that. I'll send that a text to others. We all share the text and we pray for that person. Those kind of things are relatively easy for us. When we, in the moment, in the crisis, we are all about prayer. And that's a good thing. I'm not negating that. I'm not saying we shouldn't be doing that. What we are not good at is a structured prayer time. Is setting aside a time that this is my time for prayer. These guys, it's 3 o'clock. Hey, it's 3 o'clock. It's time for prayer. They were so connected. They were so structured in their prayer time that you could put it in the calendar. Can you put your prayer time in your calendar? Could you do that? Is your prayer life such that, is it structured, patterned enough that you would say, oh yeah, 7 a.m. every day. That's my prayer time. Or is it haphazard? Is it random? Is it, when a need comes up or when a problem arises? I think that as we look at them and they are ready to enter everything in this, when they're ready to select a disciple, when they're waiting for word from Jesus, it's always preceded by prayer. We pray and then we go. And so they're ready to go into the mission field. And the first thing that they're doing is they're praying. In fact, they're on their way to pray. And so the mission is accomplished with a structured prayer life. And we need to think in those terms. Hudson Taylor, great missionary to China, said this: you must go forward on your knees. You must go forward on your knees. We look at whatever it is that God has planned for us, whatever it is, wherever it is He's leading us to, I think that begins on our knees. We move forward on our knees, prayerfully, structured. I'd encourage you that if you can't answer, yes, I have a structured prayer time, you begin to incorporate that into your day. Start small. 5 minutes. I'm going to pray 5 minutes. I'm going to pray 5 minutes in the morning before I leave for work. I don't know, whatever works for you. But a structured prayer life that's planned, thought out, and intentional. So the next thing we see in this is it continues in verse 2. It says there's a crippled man who's carried to this temple gate, and it says he was put there every day to beg from those going into the temple courts. Now, why did he go to the temple courts? Why did he go there at this particular time? Because he knew that there were going to be people coming through there who could help him. He knew that was going to happen, and so it was like, oh, excuse me. Okay, the believers, they're coming through 3 o'clock. Prayer at 3 o'clock. We've got to be there at 2:30. Got to get a good spot. He knew the believers were coming through, so we've got to be there because they can help me. They can make a difference in my life. Now, what he was seeking wasn't what they were going to end up giving him. They were going to give him something better than that. But he knew this is where my source of hope is. And the reason was there was a predictable nature to the believers. You could predict their behavior. You knew that at 3 o'clock, this is where they're going to be. And so we look at this and see that they're predictable. Predictability led the man to connect with them. mission is accomplished through the predictable life of the believer. And that sounds kind of funny. I don't want to be predictable. What do you mean predictable? Well, I'm going to ask you this. Are you predictable? Would someone say, okay, it's 11 o'clock on, it's 11 o'clock on Sunday morning. You know, Ryan McKay is going to be sitting at the computer doing the worship stuff this morning. Mike Brandt, he'll be in the video booth at this time. I mean, is your life that predictable? That someone would say, I know where he is because that's what he does all the time. And so, Wednesday night at 7:30. Oh, okay. Yeah, I know where Fred Fortney's at. He's at church now. Do we live with that kind of predictability? And I don't mean just simply in services attended, but in your very life. Do people know how you're going to respond because they've seen you respond before? I got bad news to tell to Jason Connor, and yet I know that he has a faith. He has a secure faith. He's predictable in that sense. My life is falling apart. Who can I go talk to about this? You know, predictable. Knowing that someone is going to act in this way because of their faith, that's why they always act. That's how they always respond. And so this guy went to the temple gates because he knew that's where he could run into believers who he, for whatever reason, believed could help him, even if it was just a little bit of money. But we should be living in that same way. People know what you're going to do just because that's what you've always done, and that's what you will do in that situation. They know how you're going to respond when you're tempted because that's what you've done in the past. And so we should, in the same way, be predictable. And in that, it is going to create opportunities to impact people's life. You're going to have the chance to touch other people's life because they know that you're the person to go to in that situation that they find themselves in. Is your faith predictable? Is your faith life predictable? I mean, can you even predict it? Do you know where you're going to be when church is going on? Can you predict, well, I'll be praying at that time? Do you know so much, is your life so in tune with God that you know pretty much the choices that you're going to make in regards to your faith, a predictability. The next thing that we see in this is that when Peter and John are about to enter in, they run into this guy who's kind of an awkward kind of wording here in this whole thing, where it's like, look at me. It's like we do with our kids. Hey, here, look at me, okay? You know, I'm talking to you, look at me. You know how we do when you're talking to your kid and they're like, they either don't want to hear what you're saying, or they're distracted by something else, and you're like, hey, look here, right here. You know, I want to make sure you get what I'm saying. And so that's what I get in this whole interaction between Peter and John and this crippled guy. It's like, hey, look at me, right here. This guy's thinking he's going to give me some money. They're going to give me something. That's what it says. That he was expecting they were going to give him something, so they're like, look, we're going to give you something, but you got to listen to me. I got something really important that you need to hear. And so they make sure that they connect with the guy. That this isn't just some random throwing a buck at him. This isn't just throwing a couple coins in his guitar case and just moving on through. This is we're gonna talk. We're going to interact. I'm gonna tell you something really important. And this is critical for this reason. That we can so much trust in the programs and the buildings and all the nice things about ministry that we forget that what it is about is people. It is about people. It is about touching people's lives and interacting with people. And so, we're not just going to depend. Programs are wonderful. I love programs. I love snow camp. Only for this reason. It creates an opportunity to interact with people, with kids. And so everything that we do should, in some way, lead us to that so that we aren't simply trusting in programs. We don't just throw up a program and say, yep, good, we covered that. We've handled our discipleship through that. We've handled our evangelism through that. We are intentionally working to touch people's lives. Ministry is not about programs. Ministry is about people. Ministry is not about buildings. It's about people. and everything we do should touch people's lives in some way. The mission is accomplished. The mission is accomplished. It's not an impersonal program, but a personal encounter. The next thing we see is Peter says to him, "Silver and gold I don't have, but what I have I give to you in the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth. Walk." This man had a need. He had a couple of big needs. But his need, he thought, was he needed money. He said, because of his condition, he was put in, this is how he had to live. It's how he had to provide for himself. So he sits at that gate, and his need, in his mind, is money. Here's what we as a church need to do as we go on mission. We need to look into our world, look into our community. We need to see what the need is, and we need to meet that need. We need to identify the need. The mission will be accomplished when we identify the need and we meet the need. Now, there are huge needs in our community, and you would be surprised. The number of times I come in here on a particular day, and I listen to the messages, and there are people, I need help with my oil bill. I mean, if we wanted, we could do that all the time. We could be the oil bill church. We could just take all our offerings and make that our mission, paying oil bills. And I'm not saying that we shouldn't pay oil bills. What I'm saying is that we look at the need, but it requires discernment. We need to look at the community, look at the need, and discern what is truly the need and what is the most important need and the need that needs met. And here's what happened in this case. They looked at him. He had a need, and they met that need. But they saw that there was a need that he didn't, first, there was a need he didn't think was even possible to be met. That was the whole idea of walking. But even beyond that, there was an even greater need. And that was his need for Jesus. His need for salvation and redemption in his life. And so, the mission is accomplished when the church identifies and meets the greater need, the greatest need, and that's Jesus. And so every situation that we come into, any time that we're dealing with some kind of need in our life, in our community, then we need to make certain that we are connecting them with the greater need, the greatest need. And so that somebody has a problem in their life, do we respond? Do we try to help them? Absolutely. But ultimately, that needs to lead them to Christ. That needs to point them to Jesus, because that is the greatest need. Most people don't know that. They think that their greatest need is their oil bill. They think that their greatest need is their marriage that's falling apart. They think that their greatest need is the job that they just lost. That whatever it is, the greater need is always Christ. And so we help them with that physical, tangible need, certainly, but only with the understanding that ultimately we're taking them to the foot of the cross, to leading them to Jesus. And so they take him by the right hand, and he helps him up, and instantly the man's feet and ankles become strong. Notice this. Peter and John have been very specifically gifted. They have been gifted by God to heal people. Pretty cool. Pretty awesome to have that gift. They have that gift. And that gift functioned in the church. But now we see that gift is functioning outside of the church. That it wasn't intended simply to keep in the fellowship and just to share with one another. We're going to heal everybody in here. They went out the doors and they began to use the gift that was given to them in the culture, in the world. It was not intended simply to be shared among one another. When we think about spiritual gifts, if I start talking to people about spiritual gifts, they immediately think in this way. And this isn't necessarily a bad thing, but they think, okay, how can I serve in the church? How have I been gifted that I can serve in within the church? That is Crossview or wherever you attend church. And maybe that's not a bad thing, but we need to understand this. Your gift was not simply given to you for the benefit of simply us, the believers. Your gift has an application outside the church. And so in this case, here they are walking in the street, and they run into a guy that I'm sure they had no idea they were going to run into. And they use the gifts that have been given them to help him. The mission is accomplished when the church serves not just the church, but also the world. We understand that we have a responsibility not simply to one another, but also to the world. And just as they use the gifts that were given them, to the world, the gifts that have been given to you, your abilities, the special abilities you have been given, are to serve the world with too. The unique gift that each member of the church has received has an application that is transferable to the world. You believe that? The unique gift that you have in this church has an application that's transferable to the world. Whatever it is that you are good at in the church has an application in the world. And I'll use my life as an example to kind of help you understand that. When I was a young man, I had opportunities to preach in my church in Calvin. And I can remember being encouraged by people. Hey, you know, you're pretty good at that. You know, you should be a preacher. I remember hearing that from Sam Miller years ago at Calvin. And I began to speak in my church. And you know what that led to? Opportunities to speak in the community. I started getting invited to the Rotary Club. And I spoke at the Rotary Club. Now, I didn't present the gospel at the Rotary Club. But it was an opportunity to connect with people in the Rotary Club that ultimately gave me an opportunity to share who Jesus was. But it was the Rotary Club. At the hospital, I was working at the hospital. They had an annual awards banquet, and they asked me to be the speaker for the awards banquet. I started having opportunities to speak, not just to you all, but to people outside of the church. And when we have been gifted in a particular way, it is going to enable us to serve the world in that way. There's a transferable application to the world. Whatever you're good at in here transfers to some use out there. And so Peter and John take that ability, that gift, and they don't keep it just to themselves in their church. They reach out into the community that they live, into their Jerusalem. So what comes next then? In our lives, what comes next? Well, normally, here's what we do in the church. We get some program rolling. We get our discipleship rolling, or our evangelism rolling, whatever it is, our snow camp rolling. You get it rolling, and it's just like, it's perpetual. It just rolls. We got it going. We don't even have to worry about it anymore. It's rolling. And we think that that's the goal. You know, we got to keep snow camp going, right? That's not the goal. The goal is never the program. The goal is never the building. The goal is something more important than that, something bigger than that. And we see it in this situation right here. What we need to do sometimes, we need sometimes to sit back and look at what the result is. Is this accomplishing what you plan? What is happening as a result of this ministry? Is the thing that we're doing here, is it of value? And so what do we measure that against? Well, let's go back and look at Peter and John's experience here. At what happens here. It says that he jumped to his feet and began to walk. Then he went with them into the temple courts, walking and jumping and praising God. When all the people saw him walking and praising God, they recognized him as the same man who used to sit begging at the temple gate called Beautiful, and they were filled with wonder and amazement at what had happened to him. There's a quote on your bulletin from not a spiritual guy, but I think a very wise man, and that is Winston Churchill. Winston Churchill said, "However attractive your strategy, it's helpful to occasionally look at the results." Boy, that is great advice for us in the church. Don't just start something and just think because it's gone, it's good, and we'll just roll it into forever. Every once in a while, we got to sit back and look at what the results are. And so we look at this story, at Peter and John and the crippled man. What are the results? First of all, this guy's life has been changed dramatically. He is no longer a beggar. This guy's walking and jumping. I don't know if he got a job. I don't know what happened the next week. I know that he's connected with Christ at this point. His life has been changed. The mission is accomplished when lives are changed. That's a result. That's the first result we're looking for. Our lives changed. And so, as a fellowship here at Crossview, and we want to ask the question, are we doing anything? Are we accomplishing anything? Or are we just here just to have a fun time together? Are we accomplishing anything? Here's the question. Are lives being changed? When you look around the fellowship, are lives being changed? Is your life being changed? Do you know people whose life is different because they were a part of the ministry here? Or were affected by the ministry here? That's the first thing. Our lives changed. The second thing we see is then, what does he do after his life is changed? He runs into the temple. He's jumping. He's trying out his new legs. And he's praising God. That is ultimately the end. That is always the end. That is always what we're looking for at the end. Do we want lives changed? Yes. Why? So that God will be glorified. That's what we want all the time. Lives changed isn't even the supreme. We want that to happen, but that's not the most important thing. What's most important, most critical, is God being glorified. And so as we evaluate any kind of ministry in our church and consider, what should we do? What do we do next? Should we keep doing this? Should we do something different? We need to ask that question. Is this going to change people's lives? And is God going to be glorified? And when we filter through that, we are going to have a bunch of stuff that is pointless and worthless. It'll be things that are important, things of faith, things that are critical in the life of our church. And so, so many times since we started this church, and we very intentionally named it Crossview Missional Church, I have so many people that I still don't think quite get it. Still don't quite understand what that means. And here's what I hope you get today. What it means is that every one of us, like Peter and John, at one point, we got to walk out those doors. And outside those doors, there's a beggar. There's a wife who's just lost her marriage. There's a family that has lost their job. There's a grandparent who's just lost their grandchild. There's somebody out there that's broken and hurting. And we leave here on mission, every one of us. Not just me, not just Faith Thomas, not just Derek and Amy. Every one of us leave here on mission in some way, connecting somebody with Jesus. That's why we're here. That's why we exist. As we close today, my hope, my prayer is, when you get up at 4:30 in the morning and your voice starts giving out about noon, when my hope and prayer is that we as a fellowship get this and understand this and then live it and begin to be the fellowship that God has called us to be. Let's pray together. Father, I thank you. Thank you, Lord, just for the hope that's found in your word. Thank you, God, for the encouragement that is there. But Lord, most of all this, that your word is intended to change us, to shape us, to equip us to be your missional believers, those sent on mission. God, help us each to see the particular mission you've given us and to live that, to pursue that, Lord, for your good and for your glory. We thank you. And we pray these things all in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Let's stand.